I just wanted to make a couple of quick reminder / announcements related to safety before I turn it over to Dr. Goodrum. The first is our emergency operations plan was completely revamped last year, and I sent that reminder to you all last week and where to find that. So if you didn't see that email, check for that. This week, probably Friday, will be when we do our semesterly opportunity to update your contact information for SendWord Now, which is our emergency notification system. We do that every semester, the second week. So if you want to add text or add, you know, someone else's phone number in your family to get those messages, be sure to do that. And then just a reminder that we do have campus security on campus contracted through Continental, and they are here second and third shift throughout the week. And so obviously we always utilize the Defiance Police Department through 911, and they get here very quickly. But just a couple quick reminders. And now I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Goodrum. It's been a while, at least 5 years, I think, since we did this presentation. So he's just going to give us some tips and tricks on how to keep ourselves safe, and so that we can be proactive and have a plan in our mind what we would do before it happens. Because in the moment is not the time to decide. You want to know ahead of time what it is that you're going to do. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Goodrum.
Thank you. Thank you. I was told this morning that I had to use this microphone in order to talk. I can't stand behind a podium and speak. I have to harness my nervous energy somehow, and I do that by moving around. And because this presentation is being recorded, Ryan Mays told me that I had to speak into the microphone, which is not who I am. I have a very loud voice, and usually people can hear me anyway. But without further ado, I'd like to welcome you to the Defiance College Safe School Training 2023. You know, by now, everyone has certainly heard of Alice. This is Alice, but it's going to be a very truncated version of Alice. Alice usually takes about 4 hours to complete, and obviously, we don't have that amount of time, so this is going to be a truncated version of Alice. Let me start off by asking this question here. What are the chances of Defiance College becoming victim to an active shooter scenario? The fact of the matter is, no one knows. But let me start off by sharing some information with you. Recent mass shootings. In 2019, there were 417 mass shootings in the United States. And this information, of course, comes from the Federal Bureau of Investigation. But in 2019, there were 417 mass shootings in the United States. In 2020, there were 612. In 2021, there were 693. In 2022, there were 735. This statistic here didn't come from the FBI. I can only assume that the FBI has not compiled this information yet, but I got this information here from a credible source, and in 2022, there were 735 mass shootings in this country. That's very alarming. Now, when you juxtapose this with this piece of information, it lets us all know that we need to take active shooter, active killer training very seriously. According to the FBI, education environments are the second largest location groupings for active killer events. Does anyone know why that is? Why education environment for active shooters, active killers? Exactly right. Everyone knows that chances are no one here on campus has a gun. You know, I'm a retired police officer. I'm allowed to carry a firearm in all 50 states. I have a badge and I have an ID. I have to qualify every year. I'm allowed to carry a gun in all 50 states. But I'm not allowed to carry a gun here. And everyone knows that. So as the gentleman correctly said, everyone knows if, or let me back it up a little bit, active killers know that they can walk into a place like Defiance College and start shooting, and chances are we can't defend ourselves. So I'm gonna share some campus realities for a moment. Okay, most of our classrooms do not lock from the inside. Ryan, do you know if this is coming through? Is this recording up there? Okay, sounds good. Okay, most of our classrooms do not lock from the inside. We have no armed campus security here. Campus security hours are from 3 p.m. to 7 a.m. And we do have an emergency notification system, which we've used once. Approximately 5 years ago, I think it was, across the street, we had an active shooter event going on. The notification system here that we have at Defiance College, it worked the way it was supposed to. We immediately started getting text messages and emails from Dean Marcellec, so the system worked the way that it's supposed to. Okay, as I said before, undoubtedly everyone here has heard of Alice. Now, this is not a sequence. This is not a sequence. The only thing that will always come first is the alert. But this is not a sequence. You will execute these actions based on what you are confronted with at the time. And I'm gonna go into more detail here shortly. But, you know, the alert will always come first. Now, what will the alert look like? The alert might be the ringing of a gun, the sounding of a gun, pow, 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 pow. You hear, you know, rounds going off. The alert could be, you know, Sheldon running down the hall hollering, shooter, 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 killer, killer, killer. Now, some of you guys may think, oh, that's just Sheldon, he's off his meds again. And that could be true. But even off my meds, I know that to run through a school or run down a hallway hollering, shooter, 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 killer, 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 is illegal. So when you hear someone running down the hallway saying, shooter, 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 killer, 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 you know that's for real. You know, every year, I teach this class to incoming freshmen. So every freshman here has had this class. So every freshman knows that to run down the hallway hollering, shooter, 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 thinking that it's a joke, it constitutes a crime. They know that. So if you hear someone doing that, we need to take it seriously, and we need to mobilize. Whatever our emergency action plan looks like, we need to mobilize it. We need to take it seriously. Okay, now, what about this? Let me back up a little bit. Again, everyone has heard of Alice. So you hear someone running down the hall saying, shooter, 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 killer, killer, killer. If you can run, of course, if you can run, you want to evacuate. You want to get out of the building as quickly as you can. Now, what about this? What if you're sitting, you're in the bathroom, you're sitting on the throne, as we all do, and we're playing on our phone. We're strolling on our phone. And we hear gunshots ring out. You know, I want to share this with you. You know, I'm a news junkie, and when I hear about an active shooter event, you know, I pay close attention. The people that are in the close proximity of an active shooter event, they say that what they heard, it sounded like firecrackers. I hear that a lot. You know, it sounded like firecrackers. I didn't take it too seriously. It sounded like firecrackers. Well, no one is going to set off firecrackers in a building here. So if you're sitting on a throne or you're any place else and you hear what you think sounds like firecrackers, chances are it's a gunshot. Okay, so you're sitting on the throne, you're flipping through your phone, and you hear the gunshots ring out. You say to yourself, I gotta get out of here. So you jump up, you run, and you find yourself on the X. How many of you guys are old enough to remember the Road Runner and the Coyote? Exactly. It's not that clear, but this is an X. And this X is actually used by law enforcement. The X represents the location of an attack or a potential attack. So you're in the bathroom, you hear gunshots ring out, you run out into the hallway, and you find yourself on the X. Now, what does the X look like? This is what the X looks like. You run out of the bathroom, you turn the corner, and there in front of you is the gunman. What do you do? Well, Alice tells us to, you know, just keep running. I mean, just run right past the gunman, keep it moving. You know, the old school of thought was that, you know, if you find yourself face to face with the gunman, you know, you want to try to establish a personal contact with the gunman. You want to say, you know, I'm married, you know, I've got two children, my kids depend on me, you know, my family loves me, I need to be present for my family. Well, you know what? Today, that doesn't work. That doesn't work. You know, today's killers, you know, they're looking for infamy. They want to make CNN, they want to make Fox News, they want to make MSNBC. They leave behind manifesto. The goal was to, you know, exceed the largest number of people killed. You know, last month, you know, a guy went into a location and killed 70 people. He has the record. Well, I want to break the record. So I have to kill at least 71 people. And that's the way these killers think. You guys see it. I mean, as they're walking around killing, they're on Facebook Live. They're recording these things because they're looking for infamy. So, you know, I would encourage, you know, hopefully you never find yourself face to face with a gunman, but if you do, the idea of establishing a personal contact, you should probably forget about it. Again, you know, Alice says, you know, just keep running. This is where I'm going to go a little bit off script. You know, sometimes you have to make game time decisions. And I know that if that scenario happens to me, I find myself face to face with a shooter. I don't want to run past a shooter and get shot in the back. So, you know, it's going to be fight. You know, ask yourself ahead of time, do you want to go home or do you want to go to the morgue? Keep in mind, this person is here to kill. So again, you have to make a game time assessment. Do you want to go home or do you want to go to the morgue? I always want to go home. And if I find myself face to face with an active shooter, you know, it's going to be a fight. It's time to fight. And, you know, hopefully I can increase my chances of. So again, if you can evacuate, obviously that's the preferred method. Suppose you run into a classroom and, you know, the windows don't open. Now, I've talked about this before. The windows don't open. How do you break a window that doesn't have an opening, like the windows I have depicted here? I'm sorry? Crack? Right, exactly. What you want to do is you want to hit the windows, you know, the center part of the glass, it has bow. You pick up a chair, you throw it into the window, it comes back at you because these windows have bow built into them. But if you were to break around the corners, there's no bow there. So you break around the corner of the window should shatter. You're not going to be concerned about getting cut. Your only concern is going to be getting out. You know, if you can take your arm or your hand and break the glass and get out of there, that's what you want to do. Now, suppose you're up on the second floor. You know, my office in Schauffler Hall is up on the second floor. I've looked at my escape route, if you will. How am I going to get out? my window opens, but it's on the second floor. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to climb out the window. I'm going to get out, and hopefully I will survive. Well, I will survive the fall. What I'm saying is hopefully I'll survive the active shooter event. So, again, if you can evacuate, evacuate. If you cannot evacuate, you want to hide and barricade. But as you're, I probably should have taken the word hide down. Because again, you know, today's killer, you know, people, you know, sometimes want to hide under a desk or hide behind a cabinet. Well, we see that these killers systematically come in, find small kids up under their desk, and execute them. Boom, boom. Or look behind the cabinet, there's Sheldon standing, and execute me. So when you hide and barricade, you need to develop an action plan. And I'm gonna give you guys some examples of what barricades look like. And approximately 5 years ago, when we had the active shooter across the across Clinton Street, my classroom actually barricaded. We actually went through the motions. So these are some examples of a barricade. You know, obviously, the objective of a barricade is to buy yourself some time. You know, hopefully someone has already notified the police. The police are already en route. Excuse me. The police are already en route. But I am going to talk about, you know, when the appropriate time is to notify the police. This is a technique, you know. Again, some of these pictures aren't that clear. Can everyone make out what that is? Okay, it's a door, like the doors that we have behind us. They do not lock, but the gentleman here is taking his belt and wrapping it around the arm of the door, which would prevent it from opening, hopefully prevent it from opening. That's what that is, another way of barricading. Okay, now I purposely put this picture in here. You know, I am a proponent of taking action, having an action plan. And the reason why I have this door, you know, if I find myself in a situation in a classroom where I have to barricade, you know, once we've barricaded, my intention would be to establish an assault team. The door is barricaded. Ideally, you know, I'd like to have, you know, some guys or girls like on each side of the door. Obviously, you never want to stand in front of the door in case the shooter starts shooting through the door. But I would have guys or girls on each side of the door, my assault team, if you will, or I would even be there. Chances are I would be there. And, you know, I'm a golfer. I like to golf. Sometimes when I'm stressed out, sitting up in my office, I pick up my little putter and, you know, I just, you know, I practice putting a little bit. I've been putting. Completely innocuous, non-threatening. It's not in my office for a weapon. I do it, like I said, because I like to golf and it's relaxing for me. However, if I find myself in my office and someone and an active shooter is trying to get in, I could probably also use this President Mencken, Dr. Caldwell, as a shell and get rid of it. And of course, I would comply. I do as I'm told. But like I said, it is not a weapon. This is not a weapon. I do this because I like to relax. So, but like I said, if I had to use the tools at my disposal, I would definitely use this as a defense if I had to. You know, some other things, you know, wasp spray. You know, you can shoot a can of wasp spray for like 20 feet or so. You know, it burns the eyes. It burns the eyes. And over in Schauffler, and this is no joke, Tess will attest, we have problems with bees and wasps over in Schauffler. Again, you know, I can shoot this from 20 feet away. So, you know, I keep this in my office, and so does Professor Yakis Brown. She keeps a can of this in her office as well. You know, my little tape holder weighs about 4 pounds. Can you imagine getting hit in the face with this? Yeah, it would hurt. stapler, you know, also a good tool. Trace, she knows me. She doesn't know if I'm on my meds or not. So she's like, yeah, exactly. He might really throw this. But, you know, you can use those things to distract, you know, a shooter, to mess up his OODA loop, OODP. It stands for observe, orient, it's escaping me now. Observe, orient, defend. Okay, we'll skip that. The goal is to distract the shooter, to buy yourself a little time in order to act. Whether it's for your assault team to engage the shooter, or, you know, just to buy yourself some more time. And these things that I showed you, I think would be very good at doing just that. So, you've barricaded, you've got your assault team in place, and now you can safely, you know, dial 911. You know, dial 911, you know, let the police, you know where you are, let the police know where the shooter is. I'm over in Schaufler Hall, it's a black male, he's wearing, you know, a white shirt, black pants, a ball cap, and he's on the second floor. Now, again, you only want to dial 911 when you can safely do so. So, you've got your barricade set, you've got your assault teams in place, and the active shooter breaches your door. Now what? Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to fight. It's time to fight. And remember, you're in a fight for your life. You're in a fight for your life. Again, ask yourself, do I want to go home or do I want to go to the morgue? You're in a fight for your life. So the active shooter, you know, he breaches your door. The assault team engages the gunman. They get him down. That's called the swarm. They get him down. Now keep in mind, if I'm the one taking the gunman down, this isn't just my fight. Because if he gets away, he's going to kill me, and then he's going to start killing you as well. So keep in mind, it's not just my fight. It's everyone's fight. And I would expect anyone around to assist me, as I would you. I would you. So just keep that in mind. Do you want to go home or do you want to go to the morgue? Now, who is this gentleman right here? This is the gentleman who subdued the gunman in November of this year at the gay bar in Colorado. Yeah, the Army veteran who subdued the gunman. He tackled him. And while he was tackling, trying to subdue the gunman was still trying to get his gun so he could continue shooting. Well, there was a female nearby who was wearing some high-heeled shoes, and she commenced to kick him in the face. And the aftermath of that was this. Yeah, exactly. You know, sometimes I say things that I shouldn't say, but in my opinion, you know, this guy got what he deserved. And perhaps he deserved a little more. Which brings me to my next point. You know, a gunman. Obviously, you know, we're pissed off. He may have shot someone in the classroom. You know, we're pissed off. We get him down. You know, once the gunman says, okay, I give up, I'm done, and he stops resisting, our aggression has to stop too. We can't continue to kick him or punch him because we're pissed off. That's how we get into trouble. That's how police officers get into trouble. They let their aggression get the best of them, their adrenaline get the best of them. Once the shooter's aggression stops, so does ours. Otherwise, we could find ourselves, you know, looking at some legal culpability as well. But my point is, you know, we have to take action. It's not just my fight, or Tracy's fight, or Jeremy's fight. It's all of our fight, and we all all have to be willing to step in. Okay, at some point, the police will come in and breach wherever the gunman is. You know, I went through active shooter training about 12 years ago as a police officer. This October, I would have been retired for 10 years. And I was thinking about that the other day. It's like, well, I can't believe I've been retired for 10 years. But I went through the training about 12 years ago as a police officer. And, you know, we were taught that when we breach a room, we're not there to negotiate. We're not there to say, so-and-so, put the weapon down, you know, drop the gun. As soon as the police breach the room, when they lay eyes on the gunman, they are going to send rounds downrange. That's just the way it is. So, when the police arrive, you don't want to be this gun. You don't want to be this guy here. Because like I said, they're not there to negotiate. They're not there to talk you down. As soon as they lay eyes on the person with the gun, they're going to send rounds downrange. Now, just to make sure that that information was still correct, I reached out to one of my friends and I asked them, is this the way you guys are still being taught? And they are, in fact, still being taught that way, that when they lay eyes on the gunman, they're going to send rounds downrange. So what's my point? Like I said, you don't want to be that guy. If you neutralize the shooter before the police get there, this is what you want to do. You want to take a garbage can, place it over the gun, and sit on it to make sure that you know the gun is no longer accessible. So, let me say this: unlike in the movies, you know, when you clobber the gunman and then you walk away and you're like, oh, he was so threatening, you know, I'm so scared of him. The gun, you know, take your belt off, you know, handcuff him, hog tie him, whatever the case may be. But make sure that I don't want to use the word incapacitated because you can read different things into that, but make sure that the gunman is no longer a threat. That's important. So, what happens if you are in fact shot? Can you survive a shooting? Well, I wanted to share this with you. In a recent weekend in the city of Chicago, 31 people were shot. 31 people were shot, and 8 people died as a result of it. So what's my point? We can be shot and continue to fight. If I had my way, I'd like to teach a class on how to prepare a pressure dressing, because there's a real possibility that if we did have an active shooter event, that someone could be shot. We're barricaded in a room and someone is shot and someone is bleeding out. I'd like to have a class where I teach my students and you all how to apply a pressure dressing, how to apply a tourniquet. Hopefully you'll never need it, but it's like insurance, is better to have it and need it than not have it and need it. Yeah, you know what I mean? Okay. What questions do you have? Yes, ma'am.
You say to run. Mm-hmm. If the police are arriving at that time and they see you running, how are they going to know you're not the shooter?
Because you're going to have your hands up. Perhaps I should have covered that. You know, number one, you're not going to have a gun in your hand. And number two, you should probably have your hands up. Yes. Okay, I would say this. If you have the opportunity to run, you should always run. But if that's not a viable option, then secure yourself in place, secure in place, and start taking the necessary actions. You know, start setting up your emergency action plan if the shooter breaches wherever you're at. Like I said, you don't want to just be hiding behind a desk or under a desk, because we have learned through experience that the shooter will find you and systematically execute you. Yes, Jeremy.
You mentioned the last
Okay, good deal.
The police came around and, like, said they wanted to check all the rooms.
Mm-hmm.
How do we know it's actually the police? Like, I mean, do we just trust them? Because, like, I remember, like, they were like, you know, Defiance PD, whatever, open up. And I was like, sure, I trust them. I was just like, dude, don't shoot me, right? So, like, but is there a way that we, like, how do we know if we've got a fair deal?
Okay, you could call the police department and say, you know, there's someone here, you know, at my door since their Defiance PD has the PD actually arrived.
Okay.
And the dispatcher will say, yes, they're there. They're in Shuffler Hall right now on the second floor.
Right.
Okay.
So, but delaying it don't cause me to get shot. Like,
I'm sorry?
I mean, if I delay, like, they're not going to, like, think anything weird or try to break in or anything like that. Like, will the police try to, like, if you're sitting there on the phone, like, will the police try to, like, breach the door? Like,
okay.
Okay.
If their intelligence has told them that the shooter is inside your classroom, then
okay.
they are going to breach the door. Yes. They're going to breach the door.
Okay.
So, you know, they are going to rely very heavily on their intelligence. That's why it's important for us to keep them, you know, informed. You know, second floor, Shuffler Hall, right in front of room 208. I can hear them out there, you know, pounding on the door, whatever the case may be, or shooting. Okay, one thing that I failed to mention. So what about this? You know, we can never predict where an active shooter scenario is going to occur. It could occur, you know, right here in this auditorium today. Suppose I'm the bad guy. Suppose I'm sitting amongst us. And I pull a gun out of my bag, and I start shooting. Pow, 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 pow. What are you going to do? Run, okay. She's saying run, okay. Pow, but I'm going to shoot you as you're going out. You're not getting away from me. I'm sorry? Exactly right. Exactly. You're going to swarm. You know, if my back is this way, the people behind me are going to swarm. They're going to tackle me. If you have an ink pen or something, you know, on your person, you're going to use that ink pen to stab me in my eye, in my ear, in my throat. Remember, you're in a fight for your life. Do you want to go home or do you want to go to the morgue? You want to go home. And remember, I'm here to kill as many people as I can. So, you know, it may sound, you know, very inhumane to think about, you know, stabbing someone in your neck or stabbing someone in your eye or in your head, but remember, this guy is here, and I can say guy because 99.9% of all active shooters are men. So you want to go home. You want to go home. And, you know, I was a field training officer for 18 years, and oftentimes, you know, many times when I had my new recruit in the car with me, you know, I would say to him, you know, what if? All law enforcement agencies play this game. It's called the what if. You know, what if? What if? What if? What if this happens? What if this happens? What if that happens? What are you going to do? And the reason why we do that is so that, you know, when a scenario presents itself, we've already thought about how we're going to react to it. You know, when you have, you know, a bad person standing right next to you with a gun, you don't want to be formulating your plan there. And coming to mind that I can actually stab someone, you know, in their ear with the pen, or I can stab someone in their throat with an eye. I can stab someone in their throat with a pen, or in their eye with a pair of scissors. You want to know that you can do that ahead of time. Why? Because you want to go home and not to the morgue. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay. The answer is an unequivocal no. You should not have waited for the professor to get back, because while you're waiting for the professor to get back, you know, the gunman could just walk into your classroom. If the professor, you know, he's heard the alert, he knows what's going on, he or she knows what's going on, and they need to take the necessary steps to, you know, survive the encounter as well. You know, again, they get back to the classroom, it's locked up. If you guys want to let him or her in, that's fine. If not, I know if it were me, I'm moving directly to the nearest exit. You know, I'm in control of my own destiny. And, you know, chances are, I'm not going to wait for you guys to pull your barricades down, you know, to let me in, because while I'm waiting, the gunman coming down the hallway as well. I got to get out of here. I don't have time to stand and wait. I'm on my way. Okay, any other questions? Yes. Okay. You know, I'm going to say, you know, the answer to that question is based on the person. You know, I'm going to make a decision that I think is best for me. If I can, you know, evacuate, you know, I know the gunman is allegedly over in Dana. I'm in Schaufler. I know where my car is parked. I'm leaving Schaufler and I'm heading to my car. You know, if you decide to, you know, hunker down in place, you know, over in Tenzer, you know, then, you know, take the necessary precautions you feel that are going to lead to, you know, the greatest outcome for you, the best outcome for you. And I'm going to do the same thing. Yes, I'm going to make a game time decision. And like I said, if I think my best option is to leave Schaufler, run to my car, and get out of Dodge, that's what I'm going to do. But I will say this. If I'm in a classroom, I'm not going to abandon my students. I do not consider myself a hero, but I do consider myself to be the leader in my classroom. And even though, you know, the possibility could be, I would never abandon my students. And again, you know, I am in no way trying to say that I'm a hero. These are guidelines. Based on the situation that you encounter at the time, you have to make a game time decision. Do I run? Do I barricade? Do I fight? It's based on what's going on in front of you at the time. Yes. Okay, here's the thing. If the daycare has also received an alert notification, chances are you aren't going to get in that daycare anyway. So, you know, they have protocols in place, and I'm sure they are executing those protocols. You know, my recommendation to you would be, you know, go as far away as you think you need to in order to be safe. We do not have any hard guidelines in terms of a rallying point. For example, you know, the action plan is not to, you know, leave here and go to Walmart. We don't have an action plan like that. The idea is to just get away from the danger. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, actually, I mean, the county plan says that the mall is a relocation threat. So if we actually had people fleeing, part of the messaging would be, here's the rendezvous relocation threat.
Okay. Yes, President Menke. So, you know, again, I would agree with what President Menke just said. You know, based on the information that we have at the time, you know, if the police says, you know, that the gunman is here, but he might come across the street, you know, hunker down and shelter in place, then do that. But you make decisions based on the information that you have available to you at the time. if you know, you get a very like superficial alert, you know, activate the emergency action systems, hunker in place. You make decisions based on that, and the more information you get, gunshot. Everybody, get on. Yeah, sorry about that. Well, you know, I didn't see anybody like reaching down for a gun or anything, so that's a good thing. Are there any more questions? Any more questions? I'm sorry? Oh, okay. Yes. You know, as I said at the very beginning, I can't stand in one place. I have to harness my nervous energy, so I have to keep moving. You can. Absolutely. Yes, ma'am. What? Let me answer. That's above my pay grade, so. Does the law allow us to defend ourselves? And the action and the answer is yes. So if you ain't, my 2 cents would be, you know, if you find yourself faced with that situation and you feel that the student is putting you in harm's way, the law allows you to defend yourself. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, beating the student up or anything like that. But if you are, you know, passively subduing the student, you know, not letting him or her, you know, tear the barricades down, obviously I'm not an attorney, but I would see that as being an act of self-defense. You're protecting yourself from serious bodily harm or death, and the law allows us to do that. So that's my 2 cents. And if Professor Sernegard was here, I'm sure he would he would support me on that. He's an attorney, of course, but I mean, I know the law, and I know the law does allow us to defend ourselves. So, from serious bodily harm or death, and if there's someone out there who might be, you know, looking to shoot us, we are acting in self-defense when we passively, you know, prevent the student from tearing down the barricade. You're exposing all of us to danger. I'm not gonna allow that. And that's how I would handle it. I'll take my lumps from President Mankey and Dr. Caldwell later. You know, I did that for 25 and a half years. I make decisions. Sometimes management didn't agree with my decisions, and I would take my lumps. But I'm going home at the end of the day. I'm protecting myself. I don't want to get fired. I mean, I like this job. Don't want to get fired. But like I said, again, you know, sometimes you have to make game time decisions. And people may not agree with it. Like I tell my students, very few things are fatal in life. So if I prevent you from taking down a barricade, and you know, you want to make a big stink out of it. Like I said, I'll take my lumps. If I acted incorrectly, I'll take my lumps from President Mankey and Dr. Caldwell. If you pursue, you know, legal charges, then I'll fight that as well. But I'm doing what I think is right. Logical, reasonable decisions. Like I said, I'm not going to throw anybody down and start kicking the crap out of them. But I'm not going to let you take my barricade down for the obvious reasons. All right, any other questions? Anybody else golf? Now, I know President Mankey and Dr. Caldwell are going to be like, Sheldon, get that out of here. But if that goes, there will be something else. Because I believe in protecting myself. No, I'm just joking about that. My rock collection? Well, I'm sorry? There you go. There you are. You talk to Sabrina. But, you know, I have this. And if I had to, you know, this thing weighs about 4 pounds. And, you know, even if I throw it at you and I miss, I mean, you know, this thing, there's a big object, you're going to duck a little bit. And that's going to buy me a little time to get my golf club. And so, okay. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you for your time.